Okay, so we're gonna start now. So good evening, everybody. Welcome to another session of Faith in Public Square. What is God's plan for marriage, part two? Before I start with the introductions, Father Melky, would you please give us an opening prayer? And then, thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the grace of this day and the grace of our lives. We thank you for this wonderful season. Where we prepare, welcome the world of love, the birth of our salvation is upon and towards this project of joy, of love that we get here to teach us, to enlighten children, who embrace the vocation of holy matrimony. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit to guide and direct all our speakers, that you would speak through them, that you would minister through them to all of us and to all who hear you as we journey on the path of our salvation. We make this our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you for the prayer. So before we start, let me introduce our panelists. We have Father John Tabernero, of course. He was here last session, so we know him. We have Mr. and Mrs. Wokedi. We have Mr. and Mrs. Emezie Ejinima, Father Melky Okpala, of course, and Father Anthony joining us. So this is a continuation of the session that we had last month, which again, the title is What is God's Plan for Marriage? It's a fully interactive session. Of course, so you can ask your questions, you can type them in the chat box, or you can put your hands up. In the interest of time, I would ask, excuse me, in the interest of time, I just ask that you can please keep your questions to a 2 minute maximum time frame so that we can accommodate as many people as we can. If I have to cut you off, I'm sorry, don't be upset with me. So, Father Mel, could you want to do a brief introduction and then we'll get into the questions right away?
I think you've said basically what we're about today. It's a continuation of our series, and here we're today. I think we're privileged to have Uche and Winnie Wokevi. They're going to be sharing a lot with us about their own journey in holy matrimony, and I'm hoping that we will learn all the lessons that they have learned on the way. And that this lesson will also be educative for our listeners as we are hearing from people who are not just reading about it, but are actually living it, the faith. So I think this is actually what is most important, that we're hearing from witnesses. And yes, so I'm going to hand over immediately so that we enjoy as much of their time as possible and glean as much as we can from them.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I'm going to start first with Mr. and Mrs. Wokedi. Can you please introduce yourselves? Tell us what you do, how long you've been married, and how you met. Yes, but you're mute, so you can take yourself off mute and then.
Good evening.
Good evening. Okay, I can
My
hear
name
you.
is we've been married for 33 years.
There seems to be like an echo or something. It's not really clear.
Mm-hmm. Maybe they use, they can use the same computer.
Yeah. You're right now. Okay, I can hear you. I can hear you.
Hey, can you hear?
I can't, if you're in the same
can you
room.
Hear? Can you hear what you're saying?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
Well, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, Winfred is saying that we've been married for and we dated through university for 7 years before then. So it's like we've been together for 40 years. Is there anything else to say?
But it was kind of glitchy. So you've been married for 33 years, and I think I heard you said you knew each other for 2 years before that. Is that accurate?
How about you?
Maybe turn off your video. Or if you're in the same room, maybe you can use the same computer, because for some reason it's not.
Yeah.
It's like you're frozen, and then the sound is cutting in and out.
Have you turned off yours?
Okay, so I think what we'll do, let's see. Mrs. Okedi, your camera, you're frozen, so I'm not sure your computer may be the problem. Maybe you'll turn off your video and let's try again. Okay, so we're gonna put a pause on you and then let's move to the other couple just so we can kind of sort that out on the back end. Okay, so in Cam Adimizie, can you introduce yourself? Tell us what you do. Tell us how you met and how long you've been married.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Good evening. My name is Chemezi Ichinima. I'm an accountant by training, but I'm the CEO of a company called White Dove Shipping Company. It's in the oil and gas industry. Kim, you want to introduce yourself?
Introduce your wife now.
Okay, so Kim, Ms. Jidima is my wife. She works for Pan Ocean, Corporations. She's the external affairs lead there.
Mm-hmm.
We're married for 16 years, and we met 3 years before we got married. We met. I was doing my master's at the time in the UK, and she had finished her master's, and so she came to visit one of our friends who was doing the same master's program as I was, and that was where we met,
you begged me to marry,
and then I mean she was lucky because at that time I was ready to marry, so I was looking for a wife. I met her around that time, you know, when I calmed down and I was ready. So that was what happened.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Great introduction. Okay, good, good, good. Inkem, is this story accurate?
We'll find out, sir.
Okay. So let me dive right in. My first question is, what does submission mean to you? What does submission mean to you?
To me and Kim.
To you, both of you, so you can both answer, but you can start, ladies first.
Okay, so submission to me is disagreeing respectfully.
Okay.
So I might not agree with something, but doesn't mean I have to be disrespectful about it. It also means agreeing not because the other person is stronger than you or wiser than you, but agreeing because it's what is best for the family or for both of you, for your union, right? So I'm doing it with all, not unwillingly, but doing it because you want the best for everyone and you want to live in peace. And then coming back to then state perhaps why you agreed or why you disagreed, but again, respectfully. So I'm happy with disagreeing and agreeing if I understand that, even if I don't understand, so long as it is for the good of the family and for the union. So that's what submission is to me, doing what is best for the union and for the family, even if it's uncomfortable. Submission.
Okay.
Your turn. What submission is?
Oh, okay. Submission. It's a very interesting question. Very interesting question. You know, because some of us grew up where submission was very, you know, it wasn't relative. It was such that, you know, the relationship between our parents was such that we saw that our mothers submitted to our fathers, as the Bible said, you know. But as we grow up and as we get formation, we begin to realize what submission should be, and we try to leave that submission in the true way it should be. So my understanding of submission is that it is not about you. So it's not about me. It's not about me. It's about us. Okay. It's not about me. It's about, so I move away from me to us. And so if I move from me to us, it is not all that I want, all that I want to happen, that has to happen. It is what is good for us. And what is good for us means that it is something the other party has to be happy with. And I understand that and accept that. So for me, that is my understanding of submission, and that's how I leave submission. You know, so it's no longer about me. Okay. It's now about us. It's about the family.
Unit. Okay, perfect. Thank you. Okay, so we're gonna try again. Mr. and Mrs. Wilkady, do you wanna mute yourself, and then let's just test and see if we're good to go this time.
Can you hear us?
Yes, perfect, perfect. Okay, good. So can you introduce yourselves, tell us what you do, how long you've been married, and how you met?
We met at University of Lagos, dated for 7 years before we got married. We're married for, 33 years now. So literally we've been together for 40 years. I'm a lawyer. Winifred started life out as a banker. Became a homemaker, and now doing different things, including running a music, having a degree in law, and you know, just those other things that she's doing.
Nice. Well, nice to meet you guys. Okay. So what does the...
We have three kids. The oldest is 33. Can you hear us?
Okay, I can hear you. I can hear you. Yes, I can.
We have three kids. The oldest is 33, the youngest is 20.
Nice. Nice to meet you both.
Yes.
Okay, so what does submission mean to you? Both of you can answer from your perspective.
Submission is more about trust.
Okay.
Build trust each other. That if somebody has an opinion from what you're thinking, there should be an edit in resolving that difference. That's what I think submission is. It's not a question of superiority or power or strength in a relationship. It's all about trust. There are certain situations where I like to think that I know better, and certain situations where we might know better. It's the ability to resolve the differences and trust each other. That's what I think submission is.
Okay. Ms. Wicca, did you have a different viewpoint?
Well, I think submission actually listening to each other and trying to figure out if the other person is right and trying to understand why the person has that opinion. And then you come to a common ground and you explain yourselves. You know, submission is not that the husband has to say this and you follow everything he says. I think you should both, as I said, you should both trust each other and give your own angle of things. Maybe he sees it from a different view, you see it from a different view, and you have to come to a common level, you know. That's what I see as. So you come together as a common front. There must be a unity. There must be something.
Some sort of consensus.
Okay. So another question. This was from, so I'm going to read out some questions from last time because we didn't go through everything. So when you reach a certain age and you're not married, people say you're too picky. Shouldn't you be picky about who you have as a life partner? So I'm putting this to both. I think we'll start with Imezian and Kim, and then you can answer. So should you be picky about your life partner? What was it about your spouse that made you, decide that this was the person you wanted to get married to? Can unmute yourself. You're both mute.
Okay, so I think we have to differentiate picky, right? There's some things that are superficial, right? And there's some things that are fundamental. So when I was a certain age, I wanted extremely tall, knight in shining armor kind of thing, all the works, very superficial, right? But then as you grow older, and as you mature in your, obviously self-awareness and in your faith, you realize that some things are more important. So yes, you have to be picky about those fundamental things. Do we share the same values when it comes to family? Do we share the same values when it comes to faith? Do we share the same values, social values, right? What about children? What does he think about children? Does he want children? How many children? Do I want children? So those things are essential. So yes, we have to be picky about those things that matter. And then the rest, I mean, nobody's perfect physically, but what's inside is important. And those things have to be picked up. What the person believes in is important. The person's background, to some extent, you have to understand it, know the things that you can take and you cannot take, because again, you know, how people are brought up and the experiences that they've had plays a huge role in how they relate with their spouse. So you have to have an understanding of that. And then begin to ask yourself, is this something that I can leave the rest of my life? because those things are fundamental as well.
So I think, I mean, yes, you, I mean, to some extent, you have to be picky. Because there are certain qualities that you want in your spouse. There are certain physical qualities that you want, and there are certain values that you also want. I think it is natural to be picky, you know. But when you ask the question, I think I heard you say that, you know, that at some point, if you are not yet married, you know, the society begins to look at you somehow. You know, I think for that, it is for the individual. Does the individual want to get married? You know, there are people who genuinely want to get married. There are those who are not, you know, it is not like, you know, it's not like they must get married, you know. So for those who genuinely want to get married, I won't say you should just jump into marriage because time is going, but, you know, you also have to be a bit, I mean, you have to apply a bit of common sense to it also, you know. So when, I mean, if one is in a position where it seems as if time is going, you know, and you have all these qualities, physical, all these things that you want, at some point you need to know what you can live with, what you can't live with, you know, make compromises, but, you know what you can live with, know what is important and what is not important, you know, if you genuinely want to get married. But I think, yes, you have to be picky, but it's important to know what is important and what is not necessarily important in choosing your spouse.
Okay, thank you. Mr. and Mrs. Olkidi, I have another question for you. So when dealing with the issue of no kids in the marriage, or whether it's you're dealing with infertility, or family intervention, or you can call it family meddling in your business, or dealing with special needs kids, what are some practical ways to deal with heavy challenges like this that, you know, some couples obviously have to deal with?
Was that a question for us?
Yes. Do you want me to repeat it?
Well, no, I call you. Well, I think everything depends on the relationship you have with each other. When we got married, we said to each other, I said to Winifred, you take care of your family, I'll take care of mine, in terms of family meddling. I'll keep my family at bay, but please, by all means, you keep your family at bay as well, so that whatever we don't resolve between us will never be resolved by a third party. So we had that clear understanding. So any issues we had said to ourselves that it must be resolved between you and me. And we've never had a situation where a third party or a member of the family has had to call us to a meeting for any reason whatsoever. So that has worked. So it's a question of, it's a matter of just both taking a position on things and understanding that our relationship is ours and not a relationship for everyone?
I think the question was about challenges, is it? Challenges in marriage and all that. Well, they're obviously going to face challenges. You're going to try and resolve it between yourselves, but obviously there'll be a third party that are interested. For example, for couples that don't have kids, their parents might start getting involved and saying, what are you doing? How are you going about this? How are you solving this problem? It's for the couples themselves to know how to handle the situation. They have to, as I said before, they have to trust each other. They have to, last week we were talking about mentors and we were talking about therapists and a third party that could help if there are challenges. And I remember saying that we had counselors in the Catholic Church. And I was talking about these days, these young people prefer the word therapy. I was actually talking to Mrs. Esueli about it, and she said, you see, the thing about it is to try and go with the flow. That even the church encourages that. That to her, counseling and therapy are one and the same. If these young ones prefer therapy, then by all means, let's go with therapy. So I think if they need help, because sometimes you do need to talk to somebody else, yes. And sometimes, especially if the problem is serious. So I think it's finding the right person to talk to, somebody who you...
You're frozen.
You've seen in church, you've seen her attitude towards many things. So you can always approach that kind of person, and she can always, or he can always give you some advice. Because I think sometimes, if the problems are really, I met a woman who for many years, she didn't have kids. And she told me, Winifred, you don't know how it is. You can actually go mad. It can send you mad. It can drive you crazy. You don't know the challenge, this kind of challenge, how much it drove me crazy, you know? That there was nothing she used to pray, until she got comfortable with herself and found her own level before. And that is when you actually need a third person to talk to, when you have challenges. I think last week we were talking about challenge children as well. When you have a child that is autistic and all those challenges, how are you going to resolve it? It's a very, very difficult thing, because the marriage that is not strong from beginning starts having problems thereafter, because it's not, as you said, it's built on sand. It's not solid. And then once you have this kind of challenges coming, you really do need help, and you need to be very strong in Christ to overcome this kind of problem. So I think it's also up to the church to be able to help couples like this when this kind of challenges occur in their marriage. And as I said, there are different kinds of challenges, as you said. Sometimes the challenge comes much later in life, not even immediately, you know, because sometimes you go on and go on and go on. The challenge might come 25 years down. Your child can become a drug addict, and then you're facing another kind of challenge. So it can come at any time in one's life. It's for you to be strong.
Okay, thank you. So the next question that I have is for one of the priests. And what is the church's stance on divorce? And can you give some biblical references? Any priest? Should I pick somebody?
I think that Father Tony answers the first scriptural question. I googled the canonical one.
Scriptural perspective. I mean, it appears in the Gospels. I know Mark chapter 10, verse 1, and then Matthew, it's also appears in Matthew. There's a parallel of that passage in Matthew. But what is interesting is that the Pharisees asked Jesus the condition or ground for divorce. And Jesus responded for me in a very powerful way. Instead of addressing the issue they brought, which was the legality of divorce, Jesus took them back to the scriptures, saying, it was not God's plan from the beginning. From the beginning, he made them male and female. From the beginning, he wanted them to be, you know, one, to live in a life of fruitful, faithful, permanent union that is interminable. And the canonical term is indissoluble. This was God's idea from the beginning. For the first time, the idea of rupture in marriage started to occur is after the fall. Now, that question that asked Jesus is very, very tricky, because the Hebrew word for that question, for what is interpreted the ground of divorce, the Hebrew word there is ervat davar. I would rather just be specific by reading. Let me read what is in Mark chapter 10. Let me read it precisely. Mark chapter 10. Mark 10. Let me read it. I'll read the English version, and then Mark chapter 10. And say, let's see. Okay, so let's see from two. It says, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? He answered, what did Moses command you? Then they said, Moses allowed the man to write a certificate of divorce and to put her away. Now, Jesus said, this is for your hardness of heart. It was not so. In Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 1, the word there that is considered a ground for divorce is a Hebrew word, ervat davar. Now, this Hebrew word is a word that I think is very difficult to translate into English. Some say indecency, some say infidelity, some say immorality, some say objectionable behavior. Now, what is interesting is that this question they put to Jesus is a trap. It was a trap. Jesus was in a particular jurisdiction of a guy called Herod Antipas, who had just taken another person's wife, his brother's wife, and has had this illicit relationship with her, and had been condemned by John the Baptist, and he put John the Baptist to death. So they were trying to set Jesus against this authority for this, and Jesus Christ decided to respond to it in a very profound way. I just thought to say that from the biblical perspective, what Jesus tried to tell them is that divorce is not part of God's idea at all. He wanted to be understood clearly that divorce is a result of the rupture. In fact, in the early days of Jewish history, close to Jesus's time, there were two schools of thought, as we always have in every generation. And one of them is called the school of Shammai, and the other one is called the school of Hillel. For the school of Shammai, the school of Shammai is very strict. You can call it a version of the Catholic Church today, saying that we must maintain the integrity of marriage, no matter what. Only on few occasions can you start even having the dialogue of annulment. Why for the school of Hillel, they belong to the liberal school today. Just like people say, if you have any difficulty in marriage, get out. So you see that we are back to that situation again in our time. Here you have the church saying, you know, we have to ensure that we cannot dissolve any marriage that is validly contracted. While you have a lot of people saying, no, just get out of it. So from a scriptural perspective, I think Jesus' response was that you do not contract divorce because it is not acceptable. Because you are hard, because you are simple, that's why most people take it. This is a kind of from a scriptural perspective. On that passage, Mark chapter 10, if you read from 2, at least till about 7.
Mm-hmm. Well, from the canonical point of view, from the law of the church, obviously the church follows the words of Jesus. Therefore, the church never divorce has been accepted. What is, we need to distinguish here, no? There are different words. One is divorce, another one is separation, another one is annulment. Divorce is a juridical fiction, what we call in law fiction, juridical fiction, because we suppose that the bond of marriage is broken. But obviously, once the marriage is celebrated as a sacrament, and therefore it's a sacrament what God has put together, man cannot put asunder. And therefore, this bond is perpetual, is till death, perpetual, no, till death, till death. Therefore, the divorce is not accepted in the church, precisely following the tradition of the Jews, following also the teachings of our Lord, following the first plan of God, which is the marriage. Then another thing is the possibility of separation. Separation means that the bond remains, but living together, not, for many different reasons. So the main reason can be violence, can be adultery, can be many different reasons. And also on these occasions, the church encourages reconciliation for the good of the spouses, for the good of the husband and the wife, and also for the good of the children, no? if it is possible. So there are some reasons that sometimes made advisable to separate, but not divorce. And then the third word that I wanted to emphasize is annulment. An annulment is the declaration on the part of the authority of the church in a sentence, no, in a court, in a tribunal, that assessed that what happened on the day of the wedding, there was not a real marriage for different reasons. At the moment of the exchange of vows, at the moment of the consent was vitiated, the consent was not properly given because some of the essences, some of the essential characteristics of marriage, no, were removed, for instance, unity. For instance, the person is not ready to have only one wife, but several, or fidelity, or openness to life. I mean, all these are reasons that are showing that, yes, there was a wedding, but there was not a real marriage, because what they were celebrating in the exchange of the vows was not according to what marriage should be. One husband with one wife, no, for always open to life. No? Or there are also, well, some reasons that sometimes also you realize, no? I mean, the person, yes, there is another characteristic of marriage, which is the mutual help of the husband and the wife. If after few weeks, no? No, there was already psychological or domestic violence, sometimes it can be a reason for the annulment, no? Because really and truly there is no love, no? There is no respect for the person. No? There can be many different reasons. But the annulment is precisely a declaration of the church saying that what was celebrated on the day of the wedding, it was not a real marriage. There was not valid. And therefore, there is no marriage. Therefore, the church does not accept divorce. The church accepts separation in concrete and specific circumstances. And annulment is the declaration on the part of the church that there was no marriage. So this is the explanation, more or less.
Thank you. So I have a follow-up question to that. So what if in the event of a separation, right, and all the things that made the marriage valid at the beginning were present, so it's a real valid marriage, right? However, mm-hmm. there's a separation, but neither party is even willing to reconcile, and they just want to be done, then what happens in that situation?
Well, what happens is that they are not together, but even if they get a declaration in any court saying that they are divorced in front of the church, they are still married.
So they can never remarry in the church again?
In principle, no.
Okay.
So, you know, there are sometimes ways of talking. The marriage didn't work. Well, what do you mean didn't work? Okay. The marriage, we are not married anymore. Well, maybe civilly, no, in front of the state, no. But in front of God, if there was a valid marriage, there is a marriage. And therefore, this is the situation of some people who are divorced and remarried. There is a lot of pastoral experience in the church. Maybe sometimes it's not well known, but there is a lot of pastoral experience how to help these people who are in these situations for them to reconcile with God. But obviously, it's not a situation that depends depends only on each one of them. It should be something that they need to work together. This person, this man and this woman who are living together, they need to agree how to live, and depending on the circumstances, the situations, sometimes it's advisable that they separate, sometimes no, they need to be together because they have been together for 35 years, no? And how are you going to live this special situation? But there are many different ways. But yes, a person when is married and the marriage was valid, they are married till death.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, in the history of the church, there is a lot of history. We have seen also how, as a consequence of this truth of the marriage, being faithful to the doctrine of Jesus Christ about marriage, well, there has been many historical consequences. So thinking of England, no, Henry VIII, no, I mean, there are many, many situations like this all along the history of the church. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Father John. I want to read a question from the chat. It says, how do you communicate with a spouse who believes he's always right? He has the best idea and he must have an opinion on everything and never takes responsibility for anything. Mr. and Mrs. Okedi, I'm going to put the question to you.
Sorry, can you ask a question again, please?
How do you communicate with a spouse who believes that he's always right? He has the best idea. He must have an opinion on everything and never take responsibility for anything.
Could the question be flipped around the other way as well?
Yes, I guess. So how do you
Well, I can't say I've encountered that. So there might be some family members I know that are like that. It's a difficult one, to be honest with you, it's a difficult one. I think, sorry, I've lost my voice. I think that essentially from day one, you've got to build that relationship. And if you have a situation where the spouse does not listen, then you have a problem. And communication then can only be maybe through other parties. I don't know what Fred thinks about that.
So, well, I through other parties, yes, but you are talking of the case of a narcissist, somebody that doesn't listen, thinks he's always right, doesn't want somebody else's opinion. That is really, really difficult because sometimes the woman especially will be the victim of this. And there's hardly anything she can do about it because that's just how he is. And nobody can get through to him. There are different types of people like that because I experienced somebody that he just said, he told his wife, I'm no longer happy in this relationship and I'm leaving this relationship. And she went to the parish priest to tell the parish priest, and the parish priest tried to trace it down. He dodged. The parish priest finally got to him and he said, look, I'm just not happy in this relationship. I want my own way, I want out. And the parish priest actually told him that, hey, marriage is not a toy. You can't get tired of it and just say, oh, I'm tired of this toy, I want to throw it out. You've got to put all your best in it. But when things are so difficult like this, because usually this character that you're talking about can also include violence. Usually it leads to violence because the person doesn't want to listen. He thinks he's always right. There's nobody to talk to him. And this is what we go back to the red flag and as being picky. When you want to marry, you have to watch out for all these signs. Because I tell you, somebody does not develop this kind of character overnight. This person has let loose in the world, whether by his parents or by somebody. but he's been there and his character has always been there. So when you're saying women are picky, I believe that women should be able to see through this and see these characters. If they really look, they'll see, because it's a typical, it's not something that the man just developed overnight. He must have had these traits. But having said that, you've entered this kind of relationship, what do? You now have to go to your priest, probably. You have to try and appeal to his spiritual side, maybe. You pray to God, you pray to Mary, the priest. They're going to try their utmost, and then there are children involved. You can't just walk out of this marriage. He, on the other hand, might be ready to move out, walk out of this marriage, because as far as it's concerned, if you don't do what I want, you have to go out. So this is a really difficult one. And the woman will always need support. I believe it could be the other way too, but that person always needs the support. And that's where the church comes in. How much support does the church give to such a woman, you know?
Okay, thank you.
You have to bring her in, as his father said. It's not. So we have to go back to the basics. I mean, you have to go back to your parish priest. You've got to explain, and he has to come up with some kind of, you maybe try and appeal to him, but some people, like some of the character you've described, might not even. So that is a very, very difficult thing. And that's why marriage the institution of marriage is difficult to handle, and it has to be handled with care, because the woman will need support, or even the man, they're going to need a lot of support.
Okay, thank you. Ikem?
Thank you.
And Imezie, I'm going to ask you the same question, but I'm going to flip it around a little bit. So I'll repeat the question again. So is, how do you communicate with a spouse who believes that they're always right and doesn't take correction, thinks they have the best ideas? Now, Ms. Nokedi had just said that these are obviously, well, narcissistic traits that have obviously manifested before they got married. So what are some signs you should be looking out for in your spouse to avoid this type of situation? You're on mute.
Yeah, I agree with Mrs. Mokedi that this traits are not just, it's not just developed overnight. You must have noticed it, you know, right from when you're dating and all of that. When you find out that someone's very opinionated, you know, and you can easily tell that, you know, the person wants to win every argument, the person doesn't have a listening ear, you know, you can't even have a two-way. You can't even have a two-way discussion. You know, it's always the person's way or no way. You know, so you have people like that. You have quite a number of people like that. You know, so how do you begin to deal with this? If in marriage this has been established, the other party has to find a subtle way of trying to put this, you know, to put this across to the spouse that maybe not at the point where they're having arguments, you know, maybe, you know, after the event, it's just, you know, you try to put this across that, you know, that you actually realize that this is your attitude. I mean, the thing is that the other party may not even really know that this is how he or she is, you know. So you need to, you know, in a subtle way, try to bring this across to the person to understand that this is how you are. You're quite opinionated. You don't allow someone. I mean, you don't listen to people's views and all of that. You know, I believe it's something that, I mean, it will also take time to be able to make that kind of person move away from such behavior, from such attitude. But you know, it's little by little, bit by bit, and try not to do that when you know when you're having that argument. You know, since you've established that that's the kind of person that person needs. You know, so you try to, in a subtle way, try to, you know, let that person know, you know. And obviously, if your spouse is that way, you have to try as much as possible. I guess what I'm trying to say is that you have to, you know, you have to try to, you have to try to manage it, you know, and don't come, you know, in the same aggression, the same, you know, you just have to now come in. I mean, you now have to be a bit submissive, you know, just a bit submissive in order to overcome that, you know, in order to overcome that issue or that problem.
I'm gonna ask the priest, because yes. I think the person elaborated on, I guess, the situation. And so she says, in one instance, when I mentioned going to our priest, he warned that I should never try it or that would be the end of the marriage. So there's definitely some control there. Sincerely, these traits were not there before, but they started manifesting when he stopped working and insecurity started. So, I think this is a personal experience. So from a priest's perspective, I'm going to assume that you probably dealt with something like this. How should this person navigate this issue?
Well, obviously when we talk about narcissistic personality, we talk about a kind of a pathological character. So, and therefore, we can, obviously, all of us, we have narcissistic tendencies, okay? The problem is when these tendencies are out of control for different reasons, as we have just read, no? Because this person has stopped working and therefore feels insecure. Mm-hmm. And it can be a kind of coming out, no? I mean, and then he or she wants to have everything under control. He doesn't trust anybody. He only trusts himself. He thinks that he's always right. There are many manifestations anyway. But obviously, all this needs, on one hand, the patience of the other spouse, as Simesi was saying, no? I mean, more than to be submissive. Well, you need to understand that this person is going through a special situation and we need to help. How? Be patient. Yeah, endure all this. And sometimes you have to endure quite a lot. Then on the other hand, also, we need to because in spite of all these situations, there are also good moments. So in all the crises, in all the situations where there is a lot of, maybe a situation like this, no? That the person feels is always right, and then all these narcissistic personalities or indicators, no? I mean, and then you need to be patient, but at the same time, we need to be able to dialogue. And then to help the person, well, to come out from this and to see the damage that is causing to the other spouse, and if it is the case, also the children, and then the friends. And then in this case also, if possible, it's good to recommend a therapist or a specialist or just a bit of a spiritual help sometimes can help a lot, you know, or sometimes also, somebody independent that will help the person to think of what is going on, how to find solutions to the different problems. No, I mean, there are different ways anyway. But obviously, I mean, another thing is a person who is narcissistic. A person who is narcissistic, if you have been dating with this person and you didn't realize that it's narcissistic, well, you are blind. I mean, then, because the narcissistic person is a person who is possessive, is using you constantly, is always thinking in his own, her own interest. The other person is a means for whatever. For instance, when you find sometimes people who are narcissistic and then they are fighting each other constantly, it can be for different reasons. I mean, because one of them is narcissistic or because the two of them are narcissistic. If you want to know the person is narcissistic, you just try to be a bit against what he or she is saying. Try to give objective reasons why she or he is wrong. And they will deny everything. In fact, if they are claiming that the other person is always guilty, okay, you just tell them, well, I think that you're also part of the cause of the problem. They will jump off and they will deny it. You want to confirm precisely that they have broken a marriage and maybe this marriage is a cause of annulment because of this selfishness at the end of the day, you know? I mean, this pathological selfishness. Tell the person that maybe you are the cause of the annulment. And they will deny because they cannot accept that they are the cause of the failure of their own marriage. I mean, but these are different cases from a temporary situation that is triggered by another reason different from a narcissistic person. No? These are, well, changes of character or a bit of personality, but it's not a narcissistic personality. No? I mean, there are different situations, I think. No? So patience, and if possible, to bring the person to reason. And if possible, also with intervention of a specialist or a third person that can help the person in this temporary situation to think, to put a bit of distance to all the situation and not to overreact. We talk about narcissistic personality or a reaction which is narcissistic, no? Which is the consequence of lack of security. No? Other people have anxieties. People get afraid, you know. Other people react in ways that they don't want to come out. They get a depression. I mean, there are different reactions in facing difficulties of life. I mean, I think that this is all.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Brother John. And Kim, you wanted to add something?
Yes, I just wanted to, I mean, everyone has sort of touched on some of the things I was thinking about, but I think one thing that I want to add is that the natural reaction for us as human beings when we're confronted, when we have people that think they're always right or like this kind of situation, is for us to be confrontational, right? To be confrontational because it's a defense mechanism, we're trying to protect ourselves. But at that point, what we really need to be doing is being that person's comfort, because issues like this, where you know, where the person feels they're right, and you know, perfectionism and all of these things, really come down to hurts, right? Insecurities, maybe because they're faced with memories of rejection, and so that's where healing comes in. This person is this way because they have not healed from certain wounds that have caused them to create this narcissistic behavior where they cannot be spoken to and they're always right. So we have to just, again, pray through, you know, encourage, I guess, the sacrament of reconciliation so that they are able to really heal from those past hurts and then begin to engage in therapy and things that would help marriage flourish.
Thank you. Okay, so Aaron, you had your hand up, so you can just ask your question.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Mine is not really a question. I've heard a lot of people speak, and it doesn't appear to me when somebody says that you are, I'm going to be 30 years in marriage in May, and I have children too who are married, or have a child who is married, and other children who are trying to get married. And I'm a leader in church. I'm coordinator in charismatic, and a lot of people talk to me. So I there's so much grammar in the conversation that we're having, and I wonder whether the normal people that comes to us to say they want to marry, whether they won't understand narcissistic behavior and these type of things. And I hear people say, you want to get married to somebody, you didn't see the traits. If we keep looking for traits, we'll never get married. If we keep looking for every trait, looking for these traits, because all of us, we are imperfect as we are. And 30 years in marriage, the imperfection will continue. And even till the end. Isn't there a place where, you know, even in marriage, you concentrate on, like Father John has said, on the good aspects of people? Because people will never be perfect, you know? And I hear, you know, submission to a man. Man can never submit to man. The only person you can actually submit to is to God, really. So I'm not expectant, from my own point of view, from my own thinking, I'm not expecting my wife to be submissive to me. I'm expecting her, I'd rather have to be submissive to God. You know, if she's submissive to God concerning me, then I'm fine. You know, then if she expected me to be submissive fully to her, I can never meet her expectation, and that's just the truth. I've done 30 years. Never. She can never meet my expectation. You know, from things I see my father those days, he said he brought my mother to her and they're married. Fantastic marriage of God knows 60 years and all of that. So in all of this, I want us to keep it very simple. That man cannot change man. It's only God that can change a man. If your husband has, you know, life happens really, truly. You know, life happens. I can never say I'm the same when I got married at 24 years, 24. I did not have an understanding of marriage whatsoever. I was not taught at all, never taught. I don't understand nothing. Just like the girl, married the girl, full stop. Because I'm an only son, my father says, okay, these two is our only son, so I need to get married on time, blah, blah, blah. So that's how we just went in. So, and, you know, the place of priests, you know, I'm here, yeah, priest, but will a priest come and live with you inside the house? The answer is no. You know, I run, I'm head of Charismatic, and one of my members came to beat the other, the wife, and after some time, serious consequences happened, and they came to me to blame me that I should have been, I said, I don't live in your houses. Yes, they come to me, we counsel them, we talk to them, but when that incident happened, you know, I was not in the house. So in summary, what I think in my own mind is that I'm not expected to change somebody who is like 50 something years going to 60 years all of a sudden, and I hope that person now becomes a model. I rather concentrate on the good and beautiful attribute of that person. Even if the person says he's not understanding me, he's not hearing me, the aspect in which he's hearing me, I latch onto that aspect and we have a good and a fantastic and wonderful relationship on that aspect. The other aspect, I hand it over to God, because if the person turns around, probably the person will not even want me, the person begins to say, okay, Merums, you are like this, you are like this, you are like this. And the truth about it is that we are going old. And the older we get, the more difficult it is for us to really, 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 really change. I'm not saying there's no place for changes. So what I'm just saying in summary is that we should learn to accommodate each other weaknesses, because the weaknesses will not go away anyway. There's no place where it will not be hooray, everybody happy, everybody 100%, everybody. The only place where you have a perfect marriage is the wedding supper of the Lamb, who's going to be in heaven. So I want to encourage everybody to please the grammar, the psychologist, everybody, that's fine. Heavy grammar, heavy persona types, heavy those grammar. Even as I'm talking now, I'm well advanced. I don't even understand those psychological definitions of people and all of that. And I don't think I want to really read about it really, truly, because I mean, you know, I don't know what to do for me. I don't know how many I can read, to become an expert. So in summary, that's just my thinking. I don't know what I'm telling it right. I mean, I'm just, just normal.
Thank you. Father Anthony, you wanted to say something?
I was going to say that I was having this conversation recently with Father Melky, and I was saying to him that I only discovered recently that when we think of people being insecure, we often think of people who don't have much, who don't have much to offer. And I think that I'm beginning to think that the most insecure people are actually the most gifted people. It's just not enough. So there is this latent rivalry that the most insecure people are the most gifted people. They have a lot, but it's just not enough. And if one is in a union with someone who is insecure about something, I think that, like Nkem said, you are dealing with somebody who is not a villain. He's also a victim in a way, which means that person needs to heal from something. That person needs to heal from something he's carried or she's carried for many years without realizing it. It might just be somebody who has always been ahead in everything, and suddenly life has happened. He can no longer be ahead. It might just be somebody who has always gotten things his or her way, and suddenly life has happened and things are no longer going that way. And the person has not reconciled himself or herself to the fact that this is life. Life happens in seasons. I did not fall in love with this person, as we learned yesterday, for the particular season I met him. I fell in love with this individual. So when the season of joy comes, we go through it together. When the season of sadness comes, we go through it together. When the season of lack of job comes, we go through it together. I fell in love with the individual, not with the season. Not with the season when she was fair or when he was tall and slim, and now he's big. I married this. I didn't marry those seasons. I married the individual. And this individual remains even as seasons change. You know, we read from the Bible that life is seasons. And then last thing I want to say, I mean, I love this perspective that Brother Aaron's brought, but I want to bring a point. I've had to deal with a case where the main cause of the problem in the marriage is that one of the spouses says that this is what God has told me to do. You know what I mean? Like, I will not listen to anything but what God has told me to do. God has told me to do A. So what you are telling me to do, I will not do it because I listen to only God. Now, this is an appeal to a divine authority, but for me, this appeal to divine authority also needs discernment. So one thing I will recommend is that find someone who can reach these people. There is someone they defer to. There is somebody somewhere they listen to. It could be a priest, it could be a lay person, it could be a mentor. There is just one person that they defer to. If you find that individual or those people, reach out to them. One way, people, they are not relating with those people from that superiority dimension. They're actually having a dialogue, a conversation with such people. So just to be clear, don't presume that the insecure people are those who lack or those who have nothing. Sometimes the people who feel most insecure are those who are actually gifted. Either life has happened, but they just don't think they have enough, or they see something they compare themselves to. They're always benchmarking, you know, their wife or their husband. And as such, it creates some kind of internal insecurity. And just to say, Brother Aaron, when we speak psychologically, I think that we operate with faith and science. Even those who came up with this scientific analysis, they were given this gift by God. The problem is when they think that science has all the answer. So psychology is study of pattern of behavior. And when it reoccurs, they can say, oh, there is this pattern of behavior. One therapy does not work for everyone. So the therapy that worked for them in England may not work for us in Africa. So we're encouraged to develop our own therapy, our own solution. It is spiritual, it is psychological, it is social, just a combination of methods to see how to help our people. So I think we cannot discountenance outrightly the values and import that comes from, you know, psychoanalytic study of human behavior.
They've been proven, they're proven to be effective. They're proven to support people in difficulties. It's just that we cannot use a model that works in America and think they must work in Lagos. I think this is where we have to adapt to our own particular circumstances and see what works for each individual case, acknowledging that they are all unique and deal with them according to use an approach that is most fitting and suitable for that particular circumstance without making generalizations.
Thank you, Valtteri. I'm going to read out some comments from the chat. Narcissism is not a spiritual but a psychological problem and obviously requires psychotherapy. Set your boundaries, don't argue with him, be confident, and don't second guess yourself, as they are usually pathological liars. Above all, take it to God in prayers. There's nothing God cannot do. We have another question. It says, what's the best way to manage and live with a narcissistic spouse who has a quick temperament and is very abusive, both emotionally and verbally? Not sure who's going to take that. Father John, you're on mute. Okay.
Yes, now I can answer it, but I think that we more or less we have said it already. I mean, you need the help of a specialist. No, the problem is, what do we do when this person does not realize that needs a specialist? And this is why there is a process that sometimes can be painful. Sometimes, as I was saying, you need to be very patient, as this person who has written before. No, I mean, take it into prayer, pray a lot, be patient, and yes, this person needs help, okay? Sometimes the help can be through somebody who helps little by little the person to realize that he or she has a problem, okay? And then to help the person to, well, he has a quick temper, well, it's another handicap, no? It's another thing that you keep in mind, no? I mean, but all this, you know, Bro Aaron was saying something. I think that, I don't know, I like this approach of his life, no? Because it means that, well, you haven't faced any problem. Life is very simple, and we need to try to keep it simple as much as possible. No? I mean, the problem is when we enter all these uses, that obviously psychology is very useful to understand how to deal with people, no? I mean, depending on the character, temperament, personalities, there are many things. Obviously, this is extremely useful and sometimes more than needed anyway. This is why, well, when you have a character like this that has a quick temper, that is narcissistic, you need to bring the person to have this treatment, no? With a specialist or psychologist or... Then the process, the point at the end of the day is, how are we going to convince him that there is a problem? And then it should be, sometimes can be a process, a phase of years even, you know, because it's not like a depression that you feel down and you don't know what is going on, but it's something that you have been always doing like this, you know, and the things have worked for you. But obviously you don't realize the damage that you are causing to the others around you, to your marriage, to your family, to your friends. And this is why somebody needs to open the eyes to these people, to this person. And sometimes this process can be painful, yes, but it's worthwhile to endure it and to move on and to, from many different angles and positions, no? I mean, to tell the fellow that you need help, okay? And even sometimes you put yourself together with your husband or your wife, no? I mean, we need help, okay? And little by little, we enter and the person realizes, well, yes, there is not an easy solution, mainly when the person is not ready to accept that he or she has a problem, no? Because most of the times in all these problems, psychological problems or psychiatric problems, the problem is the recognition of the sickness or the recognition of the problem.
Okay, thank you.
Let me just say a word. I think Brother Ross, you talked about this word narcissistic being a complex English term that people may not understand, rightly so. I think when we say in English someone is selfish, we are simply saying the person is self-centered, from the word self,
So if I'm always thinking about myself, 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 about myself, me, I, and myself, you say, this person is selfish. And I think it's in a language that everyone understands. Now, most of these words came from something. They were coined from something. So for example, self is coined from ego, like the good word ego, which means, you know, the self, I. So anybody that is always saying I, you know, you don't know, you know, I, myself, my selfish, we say. So for narcissistic is a Greek, is a word from a hunter. There's a Greek hunter who was very beautiful. He looked at himself, he looked so beautiful. And then he went to this river and saw an image of himself, looking at how handsome he looked. And he didn't imagine that he can marry anyone. He can share this beautiful body with any other person. So he fell in love with himself. And therefore, for the remainder of his life, he was always staring at himself, looking at this beautiful image of himself. So later on, people use his name, Narcissus, to develop the English word narcissistic, which means this individual is self-absorbed. This individual is self-consumed. For the remainder of his life, he's only going to be thinking about himself. He is the judge, he is the jailer, he is a cop. So this, anybody who has this character, psychologists have worked it out through psychoanalytic study of different people's behavior, that this is a pathological, like pathology simply means a sickness, in quotes, some form of sickness that needs healing. So the healing can be spiritual, the healing can be therapeutic, you know, just to know that this person needs help. And that's why they say it's pathological. So maybe those two words, pathology, narcissistic, sounds very big for an ordinary person. What we are saying is thinks only of himself or herself. And in that case, they cannot relate with other person. They cannot, they always cannot freely give themselves totally to the other person. Everything must be self-reflexive. I just thought to clarify the term narcissistic.
Sounds thank you.
Go ahead, Lonnie.
Thank you. So I have, in the interest of time, we have one last question. And it is, in modern marriages, we see changes in gender roles, marrying outside of the Christian community. Is there a need for marriage to be modernized? And this is really from, I guess, a Gen Z, who's asking how to prepare for the new reality of how life is now. Kim, this question is for you.
Mute. Hello, setup is this. Okay. So firstly, so I think it's to understand that marriage is a sacrament. I hope we're all Catholics here. And we can't modernize sacraments. Yes. But I think what we can do is to be more self-aware as we prepare for marriage, to know what we can offer in the marriage. So thinking about our qualities, our talents or gifts, what are we bringing into that marriage? And whoever we're finding or whoever we decide to and spend the rest of our life with, we must always also be sure how they can complement those things that we have, that we bring into the marriage. Because the idea of marriage is not to, the objective of marriage is not for you to find somebody that will make you happy forever and ever. The idea of marriage is it's a vocation. So there's work that you have to do and there's work that the other person has to do. So both of you are working towards an end goal, which is to make heaven. So modernizing it is not the, I don't think it's what we should focus on. I think most people should focus on how can I be that person that can help my partner make it to heaven? How can I be that person that can help my partner be the better person, you know, who God has intended them to be? How can I complement them? How can my strengths help to perhaps manage their weaknesses and make them better able to live their purpose? So no, we can't modernize marriage, but we can be more self-aware, we can be more introspective about things and about what we want in marriage. We can be more formed spiritually, culturally, professionally, socially, so that we're able to have a better marriage and a better relationship and better understanding. That's what I would say.
Thank you. Anyone else want to add anything before I close out the session? I don't see any other questions. Okay, there's a comment. It says, may I suggest a lot of people are living a damaged life as a result of living with narcissistic people or with living with a narcissistic spouse, which may have, of course, affected the children involved in the marriage. May I suggest that this situation be preached more, especially in churches? So for the priests, this is a suggestion that, I guess, teaching people how to navigate or spot a narcissistic spouse and offering help to the families and the children involved. So this brings us to the end of another session. I have put in the chat, if you want to, we need your feedback. If you have any topics you want us to handle, please send us a message or just click on that link. You can watch the recaps of our previous sessions on our YouTube channel, and that is the link for that. And then if you have a question for the priest, if you didn't want to ask it here, you can always email us at that email address. So I want to thank everyone for coming. Father Anthony is going to do the final vote of thanks, but thank you to Nkem and Mimizier. Also, Ms. and Mrs. Okidi, thank you very much. I think they fell off, I'm not sure, but if you are here, thank you very much for your time. And I'll pass this on to Father Anthony. Anthony, I think you're frozen.
Can you hear me, Brandy?
I can't hear you, but it's...
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes. Maybe take your video off. Because it's
can you hear me, Brandy?
Yeah, I can hear you. Let me turn your video off, maybe. Okay, so Father Anthony has fallen off. Let's give it, let me see if there's any other questions. No. Okay, just gonna give him 1 second to come back and do the final things. Father Melky, maybe we'll pass it on to you then.
Okay, so, well, I want to thank those who have contributed and for the immense wealth of insight they've given us. More importantly, also for the courage to share your life and your life experience with us. I want to say thank you to Mezier and Nkem, and especially also the Wokedis. Thank you for your courage, thank you for your faith, and thank you for your forthrightness. We have learned a lot. Gleaning from everything, I see also the importance that has been put on, you know, getting therapy. In this part of, I'm sure, especially in Nigeria, that's something that would be a bit new to our people. It's always, I think there's some cultural stigma even attached to that. For somebody to admit, well, I've got a psychological problem. People just think immediately that means I'm mad or I'm sick in some deranged form. So I think even getting our people to accept that, no, this sometimes this psychoanalysis or psychiatry process is also quite productive, and it's another means that could be explored in healing. But above all, I always believe in that pastoral approach. I really do. And I think it was one of the contributors, I think Erons, who said, man cannot change man. It takes God to change man. And this is really why, you know, the church tries to encourage, you know, young people to marry another Catholic, you know, another person who believes in God as well, because then it is easier, you know, for you to seek even a pastoral solution, because that simply opens your eye that, no, you're listening to God. And then that brings maybe the belligerent or narcissistic spouse to understand the kind of or level of damage, you know, that that they are causing to their spouse because of their headstrong behavior or selfish behavior. And maybe just to expand on Father's explanation on Narcissus, and if you think about it, I think the end of that that whole myth is that he expired, you know, lost in his, you know, self-absorption. He expired. That was the way he diminished and died. So, and I think in a way that's what narcissistic people do, not just to themselves, but to everything and everybody around them. And so above all, yeah, I think it's still important to always seek that pastoral solution. It's the duty of every priest to journey along with any couple who is going through this or experiencing it at the hands of another spouse. And it's important that such intervention is done, you know, kindly, directly, and of course, with a lot of gentleness and prayer. So thank you everyone who has, you know, contributed. I ask the God to continue to bless and, you know, make marriages even more fruitful and exemplar of love and faith for others who are looking up to you. Blondie, also thank you for always anchoring this our sessions and being so spot on with your interventions. Father Tabner, thank you also for the contributions you make and your expert opinion, especially from the canonical angle. And Tony, I don't know if you can hear me, but thank you as well. So God bless you all.
Father John, you want to do a closing prayer for us, please?
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We give you thanks, Almighty God, for this meeting we had today, and thinking of these coming days of Christmas which are approaching, thinking also that we will celebrate them, the Feast of the Holy Family, we ask the Blessed Virgin Mary and Saint Joseph and the baby Jesus to help us to be always united. As Saint John Paul II used to say, the family who prays together remains together. The husband and the wife who pray together will remain together through all kinds of difficulties and obstacles. Let us pray, therefore, for all of us to pray together, for us to remain together always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thank you, Father.
Welcome.
Thank you, Chimezie and Kem. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. And
thank you, Father. Thank you.
See you next year.